Jarn sat cross-legged before the crystal wall. He was looking deeply into it through his internal eye. He was getting better with it, seeing distant places, people in the present, and sometimes even the past. Still, however, he could not reach the one person he wanted to find, Elor Sundown. She was out there somewhere, no longer with the Juvex Rebel cell, but he could feel her presence far away. It was going to a dark place, darker even than the Sith Temple where he was. He felt helpless, too distant from anyone to be of any good. But then he again saw somewhere far away, and he remembered the power. He began to notice that he was often pulled away from other places to one location, a cavern with crystals of many colors. A red glow was glowing ever closer, and he realized they were Kyber. The red ones were dead or dying. "Paramaton," he whispered. The cavern where he had gotten his own Kyber crystal. He glanced down at his lightsaber. "Are you bringing us to this place?" Suddenly, his sight was drawn into the cavern. The crystals were now people of every race with their own unique appearance, style, and culture. Where the red crystals had been, they were all the same, glowing a conformist red with expressions of hatred on their faces. The crimson glow continued to spread, like blood flowing from an open wound. It grew closer and closer. Jarn realized he was seeing the future as it was currently written. And there was no escaping it, just as there was no escape for him from the cave. Then suddenly, he was snapped to another place. It was still the future, but this time by only an hour or so. He saw what was in store for himself and the others of the Senex Sector, and he was alarmed. He needed to act now if anyone was to survive. The Senex Rebel fleet came out of hyperspace close to the planet Senex, bearing in on their orbiting base. It wasn't much of a fleet. They had scavenged it together from purchases and requests from Alliance Command. In game terms, they had spent the resource and duty points to get fighters. With the resources, they had been able to buy 2 Y-Wings. With their duty points, they had been able to buy 2 X-Wings and 2 A-Wings. These were added to their 2 experienced pilots, Buck Rogers and Apollo Adama. The Alliance had also given them an extra X-Wing, which Duke flew with R5-D6 in the back. Davith would be flying the crusty Minock with Wynn beside him co-piloting and giving commands. MHD was in the back ready to do repairs, and Puck and Mac were operating the guns. Vresh had remained behind at the base to help repair the ground units they had purchased with manpower and duty points, and the Aquelans they had earned on their missions. The fighters all reported in. Adama was in charge of the X-Wings. Rogers was in charge of the Y-Wings, and they had a new command in charge of the A-Wings, Starbuck. Their plan was for the X-Wings to sweep around the left with Rogers in support, and the Y-Wings would help sweep around the right with the A-Wings covering them. The crusty Minock would fly up the middle, trying to cover everyone. The Imperials before them were far less defended than they had expected. They had thought there would at least be a raider along with a few swarms of fighters. Instead, they had a squadron of TIEs, 2 interceptors escorting a decimator, and 2 TIE Strikers. A single shuttle seemed to be flying in to dock with the base as well. The base itself had a little bit of firepower, but not much. The rebels were surprised by the lack of defenses, but they weren't going to look a gift horse in the mouth, so they went for it. "Accelerate to attack speed," Wynn commanded, and they split off in their directions. The TIE fighters howled into their right, going head to head with the X-Wings, which shot one of them out of the air. The Imperials raced into the center, converging on the crusty Minock as they took pot shots. The fighters tried to swing around behind, but the 2 new X-Wings broke out of formation right into the fighters' flanks. The crusty Minock flew directly into the middle, right into the jaws of the Strikers and Interceptors. The A-Wings wrapped around their flanks while the Y-Wings swung further around. Duke got the first shot off as he shouted with joy. He was whittling away the shields a little bit at a time. Since he was ahead of the pack, he took the brunt of the return fire, losing all of his shields. The 2 newbie X-Wing pilots, Goose and Maverick, each took out the TIE fighters in front of them, then swung in both directions to make sure they could follow the third. The one who had guessed wrong, Goose, smashed into the debris of the fighters they had destroyed. Maverick, meanwhile, got right behind the other TIE and opened fire, blowing it to bits. At the space station, Adama, Rogers, and Duke slowed down and fired everything they had, demolishing the shields and causing a hull breach. The base fired back and damaged Adama's ship. Rogers, right behind him, was having difficulty maneuvering behind him. Closer to the center, the Imperials had sandwiched the crusty Minok, and the Decimator had gotten into its face, tearing apart its shields. But the Y&A wings came around its flank and sent a horde of shots into the Decimator. Mac and Puck, meanwhile, were busy shooting at every ship they could see around them. Mac got the first kill behind them. Puck was firing at a Striker, who was lining up on Maverick along with the Interceptor. They both fired and demolished his shields, getting a direct hit on his hull. The ships crossed each other in the center, and the crusty Minok came close to the shuttle. But rather than firing at it or the Decimator, Puck saw the perfect weak point in the base and fired. The base exploded in a great fireball. Just for good measure, Rogers also fired at the shuttle and destroyed it, but the battle was not yet over. The Y-Wings lined up for an attack on the Decimator. One more Imperial ship taken out of the sector if they could destroy it. The A-Wings also took pot shots at the TIEs chasing the X-Wings, but they were too far to hit. The Interceptor on Maverick lined up the shot perfectly and fired, blowing him up. Maverick is down!
That was some of the best flying I've seen yet. Right up to the part where you got killed.
The Striker fired at his partner Goose, but wasn't so lucky. Wynn now got an urgent message from Fresh back at the Rebel base at the exact same moment that Davith felt a strong disturbance in the Force. Fresh's message was run through the translator, which explained that Imperials had arrived in large numbers at the Rebel base. Jarn had seen it coming through the Force and had evacuated most of their ground status. But the two of them had remained behind with some Aquellans to transfer and destroy classified information so it didn't fall into the hands of the Empire. The Imperials landed a force of stormtroopers, officers, supertroopers, and an AT-ST. In command was Commander Medel, head of the Juvex military operations. Leading them as their scout was the bounty hunter Kavra Maragon, who had found the Rebel base through a spy that he had placed among them. They had planned this attack to happen now specifically so the Rebels would be gone attacking their own station. They wanted the base to be virtually empty so they could get to the computer consoles quickly. Rebel cells often kept vital information within them, but they were typically destroyed while Imperial forces tried to break through. If they could get to the consoles quickly, they could recover them intact. Dr. Quidel Thogro and a pair of Rixar servitors were with them. He had another plan for this place. This Rebel base was special as it had been located on an ancient Sith temple, and it had a very important crystal cave. Jarn was in that cave right now, trying one last time to break through its secrets, to communicate, to find Aelor. He heard the heavy footfalls of the Wookiee. Vresh shouted that they had to go. Jarn accepted it and hurried to him. In other parts of the base, the Aquellans were finishing their work. Olek Vunti, the chief, was in the control center. Her second in command, Leon Law, was in the research center. They had Aquellan soldiers in the supply room in the quarters. All of them were setting the computers to destroy data so it would not be recoverable. It was not enough just to destroy the consoles. Bits of the data might be recovered and put back together, like shredded pieces of paper. So they needed to set a self-destruct sequence. They were a bit slow at it since technology was new to them, but they had been instructed on how to do it by the Rebels. The other soldiers had left already, ordered to abandon the base immediately after Jarn gave the warning. Vresh had learned to trust Jarn's visions, so he had taken it seriously. He had kept the two of them and a couple teams of Aquellans behind as a rear guard. Their chief would not leave until all Aquellans had been evacuated. It was going to take exactly 6 turns for the data to be destroyed. The following is a skirmish game of Imperial Assault. The Imperials win if they access any 3 terminals. The Rebels win if they can keep them from doing that until turn 6. After that, whatever Rebels can get off the board will survive for future turns in the campaign. The Rebels all heard the loud, rhythmic thumbs of the AT-ST, and dust fell from the ceilings. It was time to go, and to hold off the Imperials as long as possible so they would not intercept the data before all of it had erased itself. Dr. Thogro has a special goal. As the head of the Super Trooper program, he is searching for a secret left behind by the ancient Sith. This information will be quite useful to them. Therefore, spending 1 turn in the Crystal Cavern counts as interacting with a computer console for points purposes. And so it began. The Imperials arrived at the front entrance, the stormtroopers in front, backed up by the supertroopers, then the commanders, and the AT-STs taking up the rear. There would be more as they had endless reserves. The stormtroopers began by spreading out, searching for the Rebels still at the base. Olek came out of the HQ and took cover, firing at the stormtroopers as they filed out of the thin corridor. More stormtroopers tried to maneuver around to flank her, and they were ambushed by the Aquellans inside. Other stormtroopers were moving around the opposite side. Leon Law hurried to the corner to hide and prepare for them. As they came around, the other Aquelans came out of the room they were in and attacked the troopers on the flank. Leon popped out and killed them as well. Around the corner, the last stormtrooper group was heading down the stairs into the cave. They were met by a Wookiee, who began beating them up. Then came the super trooper wave. Those at the top rushed in single file, getting to the Aquelans at the crossroads and beginning a melee. Those on the opposite side also began a melee with the Aquelans in the open. They seemed to be equally matched, and Leon was the tiebreaker. Up by the headquarters, Olek was just holding her own against the stormtroopers, but she was slowly whittling them away. Then Kavra Maragon, the bounty hunter who had been chasing the team through all of their missions, strode through. He opened up on Olek and overwhelmed her, driving her back into the HQ. At the cavern, Vresh had it with the stormtroopers. He roared in their faces, stunning all of them, and rushed past them to kill the officer. Jarn came up behind, taking out one of the stunned stormtroopers. Ahead of them, at the top of the steps, a servitor of Rixar rounded the corner at that moment, her lightsaber whip glowing, but she did not use it. Not yet. She instead used her force push ability, throwing Vresh back into the chamber. Jarn zigzagged past the stormtroopers, his eyes set on the servitor. She whipped him for 1 point of damage. He stabbed her for 5. One of the Aquelans came out of the building on Kavra's flank, and the bounty hunter lifted an arm and shot a wrist rocket into him. Inside the rooms he had come from was no better. Only one Aquelan was left. On the opposite side, Leon was turning the tide, and only one super trooper was left. Unfortunately, behind him, the AT-ST was moving up with a line of stormtroopers, and they began opening up on the rebels. At the cavern, the two remaining stormtroopers stormed inside to attack Vresh, and the servitor leaped past Jarn to join them. The second servitor flew down into the nook, her whip leading, snapping near Jarn, as she jumped in to spar with him. Vresh was nearly surrounded, being shot at and whipped. He flew into a furious rage, picking up the servitor and throwing her as she had thrown him, this time into the plinth. At the headquarters, the bounty hunter crashed inside, searching for his prey. Olek had powered up her weapon and fired into him. It managed to bang up the armor, but it was not enough to take him down. He shot at her, winging her a bit, but she managed to dodge around the room. Suddenly, an Aquelan appeared behind the bounty hunter. He had defeated the super trooper by the barest of margins and came in here to save his chief. But Kavra seemed to have a sixth sense, and he held out an arm with a blade sticking out of it. As the Aquelan tried to jump on the bounty hunter, he impaled himself. Olek looked on with horror as the light disappeared from her subject's eyes, like so many of her people who had been trampled on by this empire she had only recently learned about. Screaming, she charged at the armored man, heedless of his many weapons. He readied himself, but she was on him before he had gotten into position, and she began tearing away his armor, her sharp, massive teeth biting off his helmet. Outside, the AT-ST was also shooting down the remaining Aquelans, and the stormtroopers were moving in around the side. Leon called the others. He could not hold out. Jarn told him to leave. They had done the best they could. He would hold the enemy at bay as long as he could. But Leon refused to leave without his chief. Inside the cavern, the stormtroopers were trying to keep their distance while Vresh rushed one, then the other. It was more a matter of how much damage they could do to him than who would win. Outside, it was equally a foregone conclusion. The servitor kept Jarn at bay while Dr. Thagro marched past them into the cave. "Vresh, watch out! He's coming to you!" Jarn tried to shout. He tried to push the servitor out of the way, but she held in place, laughing in his face. Vresh was diving at the servitor, slipping past her whip and tearing her apart with his vibroblades. He rose, his fur matted with dark red blood. The sound of slow clapping echoed behind him. Vresh turned to see Dr. Thagro looking at him with pride. "You are a fine specimen," he said. "Wookiees always are, but you're special." Vresh roared and charged. Dr. Thagro simply held his ground. Leon was running toward the headquarters. He rounded the corner and could see inside. His chief was atop the Iron Man now. She had pried open his helmet and thrown it from his head. Her other hand was coming down on him. Then a blade from his armor shot up through her neck. Her face froze with her eyes and mouth wide in shock and pain. Leon shouted, "No!" But it was useless. The armored man had heard him, and the AT-ST was moving up behind him. Jarn could hear it. The young man was on the opposite side of the base, but his harrowed voice echoed against the canyons. Concentrating on his training, Jarn moved in close, dodged and weaved, and sliced across the middle, cutting the servitor in two. He kicked her aside and hurried to the stairs. There he saw Dr. Thogro, backing away from Vresh. His demeanor was much calmer than most people who are being charged by a Wookiee. He had a small device in his hand on which he was pressing a button. Vresh got to him and came down with both blades, but much to his astonishment, Thogro parried the two blows with ease. His old arms didn't look anywhere near strong enough to hold back such a massive blow, but he did. Then blaster bolts hit Vresh in the back. Vresh turned to see the stormtroopers he had killed sitting upright. One of them was ripped in half, yet his torso was leaning over and he was firing at the Wookiee. Vresh darted after one of them, and their shots died out, and they fell again. But the servitor was charging at him again, her whip swinging above her head. Her eyes were hollow and her mouth agape. The slashes across her torso nearly tore the body asunder, and so she moved like a bad marionette with blood trailing behind her. Seeing that Thogro was vulnerable, Jarn charged at him. Dr. Thogro countercharged, slipped past the lightsaber, and rammed Jarn, pushing him out the door. The last thing Jarn saw was the woman slicing across Fresh's stomach. No! Jarn shouted, and he tried to lift the doorway. It wouldn't budge. Inside, Vresh sliced up the woman again, this time removing limbs. But as he did, he felt a large blade cut into his back. He howled in pain, then whimpered, and fell silent. He was so loud that Jarn could hear him outside. A strong man, Jarn had begun to force open the door, but it was slow work. He used his lightsaber, but he could hear the clamping feet of the AT-ST pulling up behind him, the ground pumping with each step. He could also hear the young man shouting. He had to go rescue him. Jarn ran up the stairs, and as soon as the AT-ST opened fire on him, he was deflecting the shots. The stormtroopers approached in a line, and he ran up the side of the cliff, slicing them as he jumped by. Jarn ran toward the headquarters, meeting no resistance. The Imperials were all inside trying to get data from the computers. He saw the young Aquellan up ahead, and he shouted to him, Leon! Leon had pulled his weapon and was firing. Shots were coming back. There was no time to argue. Jarn force pulled the young man to him. Leon was so surprised by what had happened that he didn't argue. Jarn grabbed him and said, You must live to avenge your people. Come with me. Jarn and Leon ran to the main road, and then out back toward Jarn's ship, the Warrior's Pride. The blockade narrowed in on Jarn, and he hadn't done a lot of flying lately. But he had learned the canyons and the hidden byways, and knew where to go where his other force abilities could help keep them hidden until he could make a break for the atmosphere. Flying up and away from Samoom, the canyon of the base disappearing behind them, they could not help but see the faces of the ones they had lost. The ones who seemed as though they could not die. It was hard to believe. But their deaths had not been in vain. They had held off the enemy just long enough. The data within their computers had erased themselves by the time the Imperial troops got to them. The plans that could take down the Empire forever were safe. But Dr. Thogro had a different plan, and what it would mean was anyone's guess. They had once been just a small band of nitwits with a tiny base going up against the galaxy. But now, that galaxy seemed so much emptier, and with so much less hope.
If you enjoyed this video, please thumb us below and let your friends know. Also put in the comments anything you think the characters should have done differently. Click on the next video to continue watching the story, and you can find other stories written by the author in the description below. May the Force be with you, and happy gaming, everybody!